The American torpedo planes are much slower than the dive bombers, and their torpedoes unreliable. They fail to score a single hit. Like sharks smelling blood, the seasoned Japanese pilots swarm over their foes. As the American torpedo planes are mercilessly slaughtered, McCluskey's formation is joined by two other squadrons of dive bombers. Flying high above the action, they have arrived completely undetected. Unaware of the approaching American dive bombers, Japanese firepower is concentrated on the Americans attacking at sea level.
If they'd looked up, they could have seen us. But they were too busy trying to destroy the torpedo planes that had gotten there first. That was pretty tragic because out of 42 torpedo planes from the various ships, from our ships, there were only two that survived.
Well, in my particular squadron, we had 21 aircraft in the battle. Of those 21 airplanes, ours was the only aircraft that returned. The other 20 were shot down.
Having successfully annihilated the American torpedo squadrons, Nagumo confidently turns his carriers into the wind. With his planes now rearmed for attack, he is ready to launch hundreds of torpedo and dive bombers to finally destroy the U.S. carrier group. But the decks of his ships are still laden with explosives and open fuel lines. It is at this moment the American dive bombers go in for the kill.
As I put my sights on at 3,500 feet, a zero ran through my sights on the deck. She's launching zeros. On this bright orange-yellow deck with the meatball up on the bow, I thought of all the arrogance. Navy, U.S. Navy carriers had dyed their decks a dark Pacific blue when the war started, so they faded into the ocean. And here are the Japanese, the arrogant Japanese with their bright yellow orange, with a meatball up on the bow. When the first bomb hits, it's like an automobile accident. Nobody involved remembers what's happened from then on. Your mind blanks out at the sheer horror of it.
I saw a Dick Vest bomb hit the ship and back in the parked planes. And the pilots were still in the cockpits, and that bomb went right in the middle of all that. Yeah, it was just a mess.
A dive bomber attacked us. There were a lot of planes and bombs in the hangar. All the planes were in the hangar. They were full of fuel, they caught on fire, and there was nothing we could do. The torpedoes and bombs on board ignited and exploded, and the ship rocked hard.
Out of the corner of my eye, I noticed the Kaga just seemed to explode into fire. Complete flight deck and hangar deck. Just a complete ball of fire that seemed to open up the whole inside of that ship. Just a roll of yellow, oily, green flash.
In less than 5 minutes, three of Japan's mightiest carriers, the Kaga, Akagi, and Soryu, are burning out of control.
And about that time, I heard my first radio call. And it was a group commander, rendezvous, rendezvous. And I realized I hadn't heard a radio the whole time we'd been out. And well, I tried to call, and I couldn't get anybody. And then the thought hit me, like Thatch had said, none of this lone wolf business. I decided it was time to go home. So I started back.
With their fuel tanks nearly depleted, the American pilots head back to their home carriers, fully aware of just how lucky they have been.
The fact that three squadrons arrived over the same Japanese fleet at the same time and made simultaneous attacks I would say definitely there was divine intervention.
As the U.S. dive bombers withdraw, Japanese commanders survey the extent of the damages.
I could only see the smoke from Kaga far away on the horizon. I happened to see Commander Nagumo being transported to a cruiser because his ship was sinking. And all the planes that lost their mothership were coming to the Hiryu to land. Our commander was ordering us to discard all the badly damaged planes into the ocean and only save the repairable planes. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. It was such a great shock.
In a battle in which the odds are overwhelmingly against them, the Americans have managed to land the first blow. In only 5 minutes, their dive bombers have fatally crippled three of Japan's largest aircraft carriers. But the Japanese are far from ready to admit defeat. Admiral Nagumo has finally pinpointed the location of the American carrier group. He orders the last surviving Japanese carrier, the Hiryu, to launch its attack planes. At the same time the Hiryu is launching its aircraft, the American squadrons struggle to find their way back to their ships.
One of the big problems was the fact that we'd run so low on gas already that people couldn't afford to have any holes in the gas tanks, but they did. And that's where we lost a lot of people. A lot of people didn't have the fuel to get back to the ship.
Countless planes crash in the water, their fuel tanks drained of gasoline. Even those who are able to locate their ships find it difficult to land safely on the American carriers.
We got back and then we started a straight-in approach to the carrier. Well, the carrier thought we were a torpedo plane and opened fire on us. And Senator Anderson pulled up and made another 360-degree turn, but he turned up so they could see the star on the bottom side of the wing. And then we made a straight-in approach to the carrier and landed aboard. It was estimated that we had less than a gallon of fuel left. By this time, I think I was probably in a slight state of shock because I'd lost so much blood. My cockpit was just covered with blood. My clothes were just soaked. And the entire tail end of the airplane was covered with blood.
I came up a beam of the carrier, and immediately from the bridge, there was a signal lamp started sending dots and dashes. And I chopped my power back and dropped to the deck. But the minute I hit, I realized there was something wrong. It was just like you stepped out onto a sheet of ice or something. You know, you could keep your balance, but you didn't know where you were going to stop. So just short of the barrier, I just pushed the control stick all the way forward and doubled over as much as I could, snapped the plane forward right onto its back. When everything settled down, I was hanging upside down. I could see the vase trying to look into the cockpit, and I yelled at him, "Get this SOB off of me."
For those pilots lucky enough to return safely, there is no time to celebrate. The Hiryu's approaching planes are picked up by the carrier's radar systems. The Yorktown immediately launches its aircraft to meet the approaching Japanese formations. When the Japanese attack the carrier Yorktown, they are met with fierce resistance by American fighter planes and anti-aircraft fire.
The air cannons were exploding all around me. I was flying into a curtain of explosions. All I could see was black. So I fired the torpedo under conditions like that. They were waiting and watching for us from above. We must have looked like sitting ducks to them. I heard some rumbling underneath, then fire and smoke came up all of a sudden. The cockpit was engulfed in flames. I put my goggles on and covered my face with the muffler. I was trying not to get burned.
While most of the attacking Japanese planes are shot down, at least seven bombers break through.
Yorktown got hit with three bombs. The first one that struck aft on the flight deck, and it was what they call a fire suppression. It explodes at deck level, and it's meant to wipe out anti-aircraft crews.
There are several casualties from that. There were men lying around on the deck with their legs blown off.
The Yorktown lists in the water. Although the flight deck is quickly repaired, the captain orders the ship to be abandoned.
Angle so steep that it was difficult to stand. I dropped into the water and I started swimming towards the nearest destroyer.
Despite the damage inflicted on the Yorktown, the Americans still have the advantage. They have wiped out three of Japan's four carriers. Admiral Nimitz can either accept partial success or regroup and go after the Hiryu. Nimitz decides to gamble on total victory. The now battle-tested dive bombers take off from the Enterprise and Hornet.